So you know this meme? Let's talk about it. Seeing this meme and seeing joke after joke after joke about how gifted kids burn out makes me wonder, is there something wrong with being labeled gifted? Why do gifted kids burn out? Are gifted kids just annoying, entitled, and self-obsessed? Yes, but I don't think it's our fault. I think it's at least partially because of the way that we were taught to think about ourselves. To explain, I'm gonna talk about IQ. So when we talk about IQ, or an intelligence quotient, we assume that people have different levels of intelligence. We also assume that we can measure a person's level of intelligence using IQ tests. And we assume that the numbers that these tests give us are supposed to tell us something useful about ourselves. And while IQ tests do probably measure something related to some kind of intelligence, and IQ test scores do correlate with some things, but just because you have a high IQ does not mean that you will do anything with your life. You could be reading college textbooks in grade 2, but by 26 be reading nothing but BuzzFeed quizzes and Starbucks orders. But you already knew that, didn't you, you gifted kid burnout you? How many boxes on the bingo chart can you check off? Times that by 10 to get your new IQ score, you miserable piece of shit. There's something else more ominous, more dangerous, lurking under the surface of these assumptions. Eugenics. Eugenics is the idea that we can improve humans in the same way that we made pugs happen, through selective breeding. A eugenicist thinks people with good traits, like intelligence, conscientiousness, or a winning smile, should be allowed to have kids. And people with bad traits, like mental illnesses, disabilities, a criminal streak, or immigrants, or not white people, or poor people, all of these people should not be allowed to have kids. Eugenicist views range from, if we can, we should avoid the birth of people with genetic illnesses, like Down syndrome, to people of different races should not be permitted to have children together, and we should sterilize the feeble-minded. All of these views are controversial, but the race-mixing one really gets my goat in a twist, since me and my siblings and my boyfriend are all dirty mutant half-breeds. Now, just because you believe in or study IQ does not mean you are a eugenicist, but a lot of eugenicist-y people have used IQ to justify their eugenicism. They're bad stuff.
A while ago, British eugenicist Francis Galton, inspired by his cousin Charles Darwin, thought,
perhaps humans inherit stuff from their parents too, like intelligence?
And then he was like,
this means that people like me are superior and should be encouraged to breed, and people who are not like me should go away and not be permitted to breed.
And then French psychologists Alfred Binet and Theodore Simon came up with a scale to measure intelligence, the Simon-Binet scale. A few years later, American eugenicist Louis Terman adapted that scale to make the Stanford-Binet scale. Terman then used this scale to prove that
indigenous Mexican and black people are inherently less intelligent than people like me.
In the decades that followed, tens of thousands of people in the United States were sterilized by the state based on eugenicist views, and in some cases on their IQ test scores. Even more recently, some nouveau eugenicists published a book about IQ that basically said that
America is getting dumber because of immigrants.
And also because
the government's paying poor people to have babies.
And also
black people are inherently stupid.
Now, this is not a good faith summary, but based on what I've read about the book, it kind of sucks. So, fuck you, Herrnstein and Murray. If you wanted me to read your 845-page book, maybe you shouldn't have been so f***ing racist. Extremely recently, Jordan Peterson and the alt-right seem to be a little bit obsessed with IQ. Now, I'm not saying that Jordan Peterson is a eugenicist, but some of the ideas he presents are kind of eugenics-y. Like, in one lecture, he asks,
you're gonna have a child. You want the child to have an IQ of 65 or 145. Okay, you think any one of you is going to vote to have a child with an IQ of 65?
So he's implying that we shouldn't value the birth of children with intellectual and developmental disabilities the same way we value the birth of children without. In other words, he's discouraging the birth of the unfit. Him and his fans also seem to have a bit of a for quote-unquote controversial points about IQ and race.
For decades, ethnic groups have on average scored significantly differently on IQ tests.
I'll translate that for you. there's a well-established disparity between white and black IQ scores in America. Now, when most psychologists discuss this disparity, they explain that it's probably because of environmental factors, like differences in the education system. But Peterson does not bring this up, so he leaves open the implication that this disparity in IQ is due to the innate biology of different races. But all of this is implication. Peterson doesn't explicitly state these things. It's part of his slippery, infuriating argument style, one that I do not find fair, fun, or sexy. Because I am not as powerful or as sexy as ContraPoints or PhilosophyTube, I am not going to debate Peterson. For the sake of this video and for the sake of my sanity, I'm going to just assume that you agree with me that this worshipping of IQ is problematic, eugenics-y, dangerous, and in short, sus. What I will do is ask, why are Peterson and his followers so obsessed with IQ? And does this obsession really help them? Here's one theory. I feel like some people in the alt-right might feel insecure about themselves and their achievements. They might feel as though they are lacking external validation, like from their family or from women or from society, or because they feel like the left is telling them that they, as a straight white man or as a conservative Christian or as a woman who likes conventionally womanly things, that they are inherently irredeemably bad. Because of this, they might feel kind of depressed and socially isolated, kind of like a burnt out gifted kid. So they might feel a little better when they are told, people like you have high IQs. People like you are smart and successful and privileged and blessed and important. People like you are good people, unlike those low IQ other people. Their isolation becomes justified by something else. It's not because of their hateful views, but because they are smart, because they just know better, and because those dumb lefties just don't understand their smart, high IQ facts and logic. People who are attracted to these ideas might find a community in each other, but in doing so, they further alienate themselves from the communities they perceived as rejecting them in the first place. So I don't just think that this focus on IQ is bad because it echoes eugenics, although, of course, eugenics bad. I think it's also bad because it just does not help the individuals who it claims to help. The way of life where you lift yourself up as special or gifted at the expense of others, where you were told that you are special because of something objectively measurable that you cannot change about yourself, this way of life is kind of miserable. Here's one more slice of history to consider. William James Sidis was a child genius. He attended Harvard at 11, graduated at 16, and taught university math at 17. Then he left academia and did menial work from age 22 to his death. There's a few ways to interpret his life. One is, after so much promise and pressure, he failed. Early success does not predict future success. Or maybe he succeeded in a different way. From birth to age 22, his parents, especially his father, exercised what seemed to be a harmful control over his life. They pushed him to enter university. They got him the job teaching math, and after he was arrested at a socialist parade at age 20, they got him out of jail, sent him to a sanatorium, and then threatened to send him to an asylum. Doing menial work meant that he could escape that control. Plus, although he didn't maintain career success, his life seemed successful in other ways. Accounts describe that he was well-liked by the people around him and continued to do personal research on things like the indigenous contribution to American systems of government. Maybe at 22, he managed to turn from a focus on his success, isolated from others, that was fostered by invasive media attention and parental control, to a focus on investigating and understanding the ideas, people, and communities around him. We are taught in schools to value and chase personal achievement, to measure ourselves by our grades, and then that becomes, what's your job? How much money do you make? And we pretend that geniuses innovate totally new ideas in isolation. They just sit under an apple tree and realize something. We ignore the influences of the thinkers or family or servants or social forces that were present around them and shape their ideas. And gifted kids and kids with intellectual or developmental disabilities are siphoned off into their own segregated schools and classrooms, and they're discouraged from engaging with students who might have radically different perspectives from them. And I think that damages our regard and our empathy for each other, and our sense of self-esteem. So here's one solution to burnout. Get your head out of your ass, Stop focusing on how shit you think you are and focus on other people. Learn about other people. Take in their perspectives. Read books. Watch videos. Listen to podcasts and learn about other people. Learn about people who make less money than you, or people who are from different cultural backgrounds, people of different sexualities or genders, and people who have lived in the place you live longer than you or shorter than you, and learn about art, and learn about music, and sports and history, and animals and plants and fungi too. All we have is subjectivity. None of us can be objective. Let's embrace that instead of trying to compare ourselves based on these measurements and scores. As we shift our focus beyond ourselves, we might form a different sense of self. We can find a way to focus on what we can do for each other, and on who we are not in some false imagined isolation, but on who we are in relation to the history, society, and people around us. In other words, we can stop navel gazing. It's Jordan Peterson. Anyway, thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed. If you like this video, you can show- Oh, my elbow cracked. If you like this video, you can show your support in all of the YouTube-approved ways. Press like, leave a comment, subscribe, and turn on post notifications. Share this with your friends too, or your enemies, if you like. And if you watched all the way to the end and you did actually enjoy this, leave an encouraging comment, please, because I am just starting out at this whole having a real YouTube channel thing, and as a qualified gifted kid, if I am not immediately successful at something, I will give up. And hey, don't just comment, make more videos, please, because I know you're better than that. Jordan Peterson knows you're better than that. Do it for him.